The reviled and feared Junkers Ju-87 emerged as one of the foremost symbols of the Second World War. Better known as the Stuka, this aircraft was the only Luftwaffe type shown on the first film shot following the German invasion of Poland, and on the last footage ever shot operating on the River Oder in March 1945. It was the effectiveness of the Junkers Sturzkampfflugzeug, or dive bomber, better known by its contraction to Stuka in the Polish campaign, that confounded many of its critics within the Luftwaffe. Indeed, its remarkable success not only formed the basis of its notoriety as a weapon of fear, but also saved the type from an early demise. The decision had already been taken prior to the invasion of Poland to actually phase the Stuka out of production at the end of 1939. On the 1st of September 1939, the Luftwaffe could deploy 9 Stuka Gruppen to the attack on Poland. Indeed, the Stuka has the distinction of initiating the first action of the conflict when 3 of the type from 3rd Gruppe of Stuka Geschwader 1 bombed Polish defences guarding a bridge over the Vistula. This returning Ju-87C has had to jettison its undercarriage. It was one of only a small number built to operate from the never-completed aircraft carrier, the Graf Zeppelin. During the raid on the Polish naval base at Hela, it's been hit by flak, prompting the pilot to employ the fitted explosive bolts to blow away the damaged undercarriage. The early destruction of the bulk of the Polish Air Force eliminated any potential danger to the Stuka from marauding enemy fighters. Thus, almost from the opening hours of the Polish campaign, the Stuka Gruppen operated with virtual impunity. Their ability to strike at tactically significant targets was helped in no small measure by the intelligence acquired by army cooperation and reconnaissance flights, which provided accurate information of the deployment and movement of Polish forces. Above all, the effectiveness of the Stuka came with the marriage of its ability to place a bomb quite accurately on target and the psychological effect generated by the noise it created when in a dive. In appearance, it looked like a bird of prey, but the addition of wind-driven sirens to enhance the noise generated by its diving on a target proved a revelation to the Germans as much as it did to the Poles. They were to be the first hapless victims of what has since become seen as the Stuka's principal attribute, its ability to scare the wits out of its enemy. Known to its crews as the trombones of Jericho, the sirens attached to the upper section of the undercarriage spats generated a fearsome howl, and it was knowledge of their effect gained in the Polish campaign that was applied in France and Russia, and came to be seen as an integral element of the type. Few weapons ever invented have come to be seen as a scourge, but for many in Europe, whether soldier or civilian, this term was the only one sufficiently appropriate to describe its appalling impact on morale in the opening years of the war. Whilst the best known of all dive bombers, the genesis of the Stuka can be traced back to experiments with such aircraft carried out in secret by the Germans before 1939 and in direct contravention of the Versailles Treaty. However, the notion of the dive bomber was never accepted. In the period leading up to the war would continue to see fierce arguments between those for and those against inclusion of the type in the new Luftwaffe. The first aircraft to be designed and built for the Luftwaffe as a dive bomber was the Henschel HS-129, which entered squadron service in late 1935. Its service life was short, being shifted to the ground attack role after experiences in Spain. It gave Stirling service in this capacity on the Eastern Front through to 1944. The appointment of Ernst Udet, a firm supporter of the dive bomber, as head of Luftwaffe's technical supply department, saw a firm commitment to the expansion of the Stuka Gruppen. Udet's enthusiasm had been fostered by seeing Curtiss Hawk fighters being used as dive bombers in the USA. Göring purchased two to entice Udet into the Luftwaffe. It was also Udet who saved Junker's submission for a new, more advanced dive bomber from being rejected by the head of the Luftwaffe's development section. The Ju-87 was blooded in Spain. Three Antons served with KG-88, and their success in action prompted expansion of the Stuka Gruppen in Germany. With the emergence of the more refined B model in 1938, the Anton was retired, and none were in frontline service on the 1st of September 1939. Although the newsreel made much of the involvement of the Stuka in the German invasion of Denmark and Norway, only one Staffel of the dive bombers was actually committed. It was, however, equipped with a new variant, the long-range Ju-87R, clearly seen are the sirens fixed to the undercarriage and the 66-gallon underwing fuel tanks. First Staffel of Stuka Gruppe 1 had taken delivery of their new charges just a few weeks before the operation began in early April. By the end of that month, it was operating from bases in southern Norway and flying sorties against the ships of the Royal Navy, which had been committed in force to the fighting in the fjords around Trondheim and Narvik. The opening of the German campaign against the West on the 10th of May 1940 saw the Stuka Gruppen supporting the mobile forces, which provided the cutting edge of the offensive plan to defeat the Allies. From supporting the glider-borne assault on the Belgian fortress at Eben-Emal to the continuous dive-bombing assaults on French troops defending the Meuse crossings, the Stuka Gruppen proved themselves invaluable. Employed as flying artillery, they blasted a path across northern France for Guderian and Rommel's panzers. By leapfrogging from forward base to forward base, they were able to keep up with the fast-advancing panzer spearheads. It was from such operating procedures that the epithet was coined, which best encapsulates the Stuka's role throughout the war. Where the infantry go, the Stukas go. Pilot of the Stuka, the diving procedure was quite specific. Once over the target, he would set his flaps to the cruise position. The elevator trims and rudder trim would also be fixed in the cruise position, as was the pitch of the air screw. Switching on the contact altimeter, the pilot would then adjust it to the correct altitude mark. He would then set the supercharger to auto, throttle back on the engine, close the cooler flaps, and open his dive brakes. The last action automatically activated the pull-out mechanism and the safety pilot, while at the same time tipping the whole plane over on its nose to begin its dive. As the plane began to plummet, sirens screaming, he would gauge his angle of descent by matching the horizon against lines etched on his starboard cockpit window, although an experienced pilot could do this by aiming with the nose of the plane as it fell earthwards. The Stuka was one of the very few dive bombers built that could actually drop at 90 degrees to the vertical, by which time it had reached a velocity of about 335 miles an hour, with the absolute airspeed for a dive redlined at just over 400. Once the plane had reached the preset altitude on the altimeter, a red light would come on, signaling the pilot to depress his control column, an action that engaged the automatic dive pull-out device and released the bomb. With the nose returned to the horizontal, he would return the propeller, dive brakes and flaps to their normal flying mode. Such actions lay behind the image of every plunging Stuka used in the war. With the Anglo-French armies having fallen back on the port of Dunkirk and the operation to evacuate as many soldiers from the port begun at the end of May, the attention of the Stuka Gruppen was diverted to frustrating British intentions. By May 29th, aircraft from all three Stuka Geschwader were involved in attacking the port, the beaches and the shipping. This footage was shot on the 1st of June when the Stuka Gruppen launched three mass raids against the port and ships. The last major Stuka attack on Dunkirk was launched on the 2nd of June. By the time Dynamo ended on June the 3rd, the Stukas had sunk seven French and six British destroyers, five large passenger ships and many dozens of smaller craft. A high toll, but the Stukas did not stop the evacuation. Although exaggerated RAF claims of shot down Luftwaffe aircraft were later reduced to 262, with the actual loss of 132, a goodly number of these were Stukas. Although there had been occasions when the Stuka had shown itself vulnerable in the French campaign, particularly when operating in the absence of protective fighter cover, the impact of the aircraft was such that it had been seized upon by the propaganda ministry and projected to the German public as an invincible war-winning weapon. So when the Luftwaffe launched its aerial campaign against Britain, the Stukagruppen were as firm in their conviction as the rest of the Luftwaffe that victory over the RAF was a foregone conclusion. Victims of their own delusions, the Luftwaffe and propaganda ministry were thus at a loss to know how to disguise the terrible drubbing the vaunted dive bomber now received at the hands of the RAF. The newsreel film shown here, which dates from this period, and purports to show Stukas dive bombing British targets, is fake. The RAF had revealed the Stuka for what it was: slow, unwieldy, poorly defended, and quite vulnerable when sluggishly pulling out of a dive. On August the 13th, 280 Stukas had been available for the assault on Britain. By the 19th, 41 had been shot down and the tide pulled from the air offensive. The poor showing once again revived the argument between the pro- and anti-Stuka lobbies in the Luftwaffe. Within 8 months, however, these mutual recriminations would once again be silenced as the type's fortunes were resurrected in the skies over Yugoslavia, Greece and Crete. With their noses and other parts of their airframes painted a bright yellow for the invasion of the Balkans in April and May 1941, these Ju-87B2s start out to bomb British forces in the Peloponnese in Greece. Operation Marita, the German invasion of the island of Crete by paratroop and glider assault, which began on May the 20th, 1941, was extensively supported by the Stukagruppen. Three Gruppen of Stukageschwader 2 Immelmann flew from bases at Molai and Mycenae on mainland Greece and from the island of Scarpanto. These were mainly Ju-87Rs fitted with the long-range tanks. With these, they were able to inflict heavy damage on British naval forces operating in and around the island, and in bombing British Commonwealth and other Allied positions on Crete itself. Within days of the end of the battle, the three Gruppen were winging their way to Poland and for their greatest challenge. In spite of the almost total commitment of the Stukagruppen to Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of the Soviet Union, which began on June 22, 1941, film of them in action during the opening months of the campaign is virtually non-existent. This arose from their close support of the rapidly advancing Panzer spearheads. They were thus required to leapfrog eastward from base to base and from sector to sector on almost a daily basis. This made it extremely difficult for the cameramen to keep pace with them. Only in northern Finland, where the 4th Stuka Staffel of Lehrgeschwader 1 was operating against Soviet forces, defending the approaches to Murmansk and the city itself from bases in northern Norway, was it possible to film the Stuka in action during this period. In this theatre, as in the Baltic states, Bielorussia and the Ukraine, the Stuka was able to roam almost at will amid skies swept clean of enemy fighters and in conditions of Luftwaffe air superiority, generating the same fear and terror among the ranks of the Red Army that had made it the scourge of the French the summer before. Notable successes attributed to Stuka operations in this period included the sinking of a number of warships of the Soviet Baltic fleet at Kronstadt. The sinking of the battleship Marat was attributed to a young Oberleutnant by the name of Hans-Ulrich Rudel, whose rise to fame and notoriety in the years ahead would be inextricably linked with that of his preferred mount, the Stuka. With the failure of Operation Typhoon, the German attack designed to capture Moscow, and the beginning of the Soviet counteroffensive on December the 5th, the Wehrmacht in the east also found itself facing an even more implacable foe, the Russian winter. Reckoned to be the worst to hit the country for 50 years, the Stukagruppen found themselves having to maintain their machines and fly them into combat from open fields, when the temperature might fall as low as minus 50 degrees below zero. Engines had to be run several times a night by ground crew to prevent them freezing up. Far from the weather providing them with a respite, the Stukagruppen now found the demand for their services actually increase. While the deep snow made movement for mobile forces difficult, the heavy undercarriage and rugged nature of Junker's beast enabled it to cope with the conditions fairly well. In consequence, the Stukagruppen found themselves employed as fire brigades, shifted from one sector to another to contend with Soviet attacks, their pinpoint accuracy as flying artillery being used to the utmost. Some of the worst conditions were experienced by four Gruppe of Lehrgeschwader 1 operating out of northern Norway in support of the Finnish-German attempt to take Murmansk. Flying over such forbidding territory in such appalling conditions often spelt death to any crew unfortunate enough to be lost on such a mission. Whereas the cold took most of those lost on operations in the vast taiga, capture by the Soviets was often as cruel. They gave short shrift to many a Stuka crew, for the dive bomber with its howling wail was an object of hate to Soviet troops. In the absence of any replacement, Junkers had embarked on an improvement program for the Stuka. The Bertha was replaced by the new Dora. It was given a more streamlined nose, a more powerful engine, a new cockpit canopy, heavier defensive armament and armor protection. The new variant went into service in January 1942 with Stukagruppe 2 in Russia. The D was to be the most widely produced of all Stuka variants, some 3,000 from a total of just over 5,000 Ju-87s, so most units in early 42 had to remain flying their war-weary B models. These 87Bs, probably belonging to Stukagruppe 77, are in action over the Kerch Peninsula, in the east of the Crimea, at the tail end of the winter of 41-42. The weather is already on the turn, with the snow giving way to the spring thaw. This Gruppe had seen extensive action in support of the forces of Army Group South since July 1941 and would be involved in the very heavy fighting in the Crimea that took place in May and June of 1942. Stukagruppe 77 also played a significant role in the reduction of the fortress of Sevastopol in June and early July, before being transferred further eastward to support 6th Army in the Don Bend and on the approaches to Stalingrad. By then, it had re-equipped with the Dora. As the 4th Grouper of Lehrgeschwader 1 was easy to film, it emerged as one of the most publicised Stuka units of the first 2 years of the Russian campaign. Due to the perception of northern Finland as a relative backwater, this Grouper continued operating its berthers for much longer than those on the eastern front to the south. This was in spite of the growing importance of Murmansk as a conduit for lend-lease supplies to the USSR, brought to the port by the infamous Arctic convoys from Great Britain. This factor had in turn prompted the Soviets to increase its air protection of the port. 1942 saw the gradual giving way of the outdated Polyakarpov 116 fighters, which had been the primary type encountered by the Germans in 1941, to the more sophisticated and effective new generation of Soviet types, represented by the Yak 1 and Lag 3. Thus, 1942 saw the Stukas being given fighter escort, and on this particular sortie, and this is seen elsewhere on the film covering the type, Messerschmitt Bf 110s were employed. During the course of 1942, this Stuka group was redesignated the 1st Grouper of Stuka Geschwader 5. The return of the dry weather had prompted both Germans and Soviets to entertain new offensive designs for the war in Russia. Although no longer strong enough to attack all along the length of the Eastern Front, Hitler was firmly of the opinion that the war in this theatre could be brought to an end in 1942 by the capture of the city of Stalingrad and the occupation of the oil fields of the Caucasus. To that end, ground and air forces were prepared for a summer offensive under the code name of Case Blue. However, on this occasion, the Red Army, on Stalin's insistence, jumped first, launching their own offensive to recapture the city of Kharkov in the Ukraine in mid-May. Rolling with the Soviet drive, the subsequent German counter-offensive was heavily supported by the Stukas of the 4th Flieger Corps, which were involved in the reduction of Soviet forces within the pockets in which they had been encircled by the German panzers and mobile troops. Conditions of total air superiority and reminiscent of the previous summer, the Stuka group and committed to this operation plied their trade free of any interference from the Red Air Force. The fighting was regarded by many as some of the most ferocious of the campaign. By the time most of the Soviet forces had surrendered, no fewer than 409,000 had been taken prisoner. The performance of the Stukas was clearly as effective as ever. Although delayed by the Soviets at Kharkov, Case Blue finally began towards the end of June. Film taken of Stuka units employed in the offensive show a growing number of the new Doras operating alongside the older berthers. Seen here on a number of Doras is the removal of the wheel spats to leave the undercarriage leg uncovered. This was often done when conditions were wet, as the black earth of the Ukraine became saturated. As airstrips in the east were in the main literally just fields, the aircraft quickly cut them up when it was wet, and even a short shower was enough to turn the soil into cloying mud. This frequently clogged up the wheels in their spats, and many crews of the D preferred to leave them off. Production of this variant had to be built up quickly, as in 1941 the Bertha had been run down in anticipation of the Ju-87 being ended altogether in favour of the Me-210, which then proved a failure. So in December 1941 just 12 Berthas were produced, and the full reinstatement of the Stuka in its Dora form saw production grow significantly, with most Stuka Gruppen re-equipping with the type by the end of the year. This is one of the very few occasions that one of the small number of Henschel HS-123s was seen in action on the Eastern Front. This particular machine belongs to Schlachtgeschwader 1 and is giving very close and low-level ground support to German forces on the outskirts of Rostov-on-Don in the summer of 1942. This was the swan song of the HS-123 in the ground attack role, its place increasingly taken hereafter by the new and purpose-designed HS-129. In the wake of the Soviet encirclement of the 6th Army of Stalingrad in November and its subsequent extinction in February 1943, the Germans were in full flight in southern Russia. All through the retreats and subsequent counter-offensive at Kharkov, the Stukagruppen were in constant action. By this time, all are equipped with the Dora, any surviving berthers having been allocated to training schools. With the commitment of German forces to North Africa in early 1941, two Stukagruppen were allocated to the Luftwaffe forces supporting the Afrika Corps under Erwin Rommel. Not forgetting the vulnerability of the type to the RAF, two fighter Staffeln were allocated to provide protection to the Stukas. Stuka strength in the theatre fluctuated, with the whole of Geschwader 3 available to the Luftwaffe's General Hoffmann for ops in early 1942. These were mainly of the B and R variants, outfitted with filters to enable the engines to stand the all-pervading dust. The Stukas remained effective until mid-1942, the highlight of their career in this theatre being their role in the taking of Tobruk in mid-1942. Thereafter, their effectiveness was reduced by improving RAF air power. While already in action on the Eastern Front, the purpose-built ground attack Henschel 129 first went into service with the 4th Staffel of Schlachtgeschwader 2 in North Africa during the German retreat from El Alamein. Although disappointing, further Staffel began operations in Tunisia in late 1942. In this very rare footage, HS-129s are caught by Allied cameramen engaged in ground attack in Tunisia. Most prominent are the trails of smoke left in their wake from the firing of their onboard machine guns and 20mm cannons as they speed towards their target. A downing of a 129 is caught in slow motion. Although rapidly committed to supporting the Axis bridgehead in Tunisia, the Stuka was shown to be decidedly dated in the West, with units being decimated by Allied fighters, with the few survivors being rapidly pulled back to Italy. Until their withdrawal in September 1943, German and Romanian forces occupying the Kuban bridgehead in southern Russia were engaged in continual heavy fighting with Soviet forces. Stukas found themselves employed on daily sorties against the Red Army. Although being used as dive bombers, a number are seen armed for low-level assault, carrying the AB-250 weapons container, which rained small anti-personnel bombs on enemy troops. This rare colour footage, also taken over the Kuban, allows us our first glimpse of the D-5 variant, recognisable by its extended tapering wings and the long barrels of the 20mm cannons protruding from either wing leading edge. Entering production in early 1943, this was the last variant of the type to be produced as a dive bomber. The termination of dive bombing by the Luftwaffe in October 43 saw the D-5 employed thereafter in the ground assault role. On July the 5th, 1943, the Germans launched their ill-fated final offensive in the east. Under the codename of Operation Zitadel, the plan was to have 2,700 tanks and SPs assembled for the offensive to cut off the great Soviet salient based upon the city of Kursk. Their intention was to destroy the assembled Red Army forces therein and draw the teeth of Soviet offensive power on the Eastern Front for the rest of the summer. The Luftwaffe had concentrated no less than 70% of its total air power deployed in the east to support the army. This translated into approximately 2,000 aircraft distributed among the air fleets 4 and 6. Of the total number of Stukas still available to the Luftwaffe, no less than 84% were serving in Russia, with a substantial proportion of that figure committed to Zitadel. This operation marked the end of the mass employment of the Stuka in the classic dive bombing role. Three Gruppen of Stuka Geschwader 77 operated in the south of the salient, while three of Stuka Geschwader 1 supported 9th Army to the north. Stuka units flew up to 6 sorties for the duration of the offensive. Hauptmann Hans Ulrich Rudel, who was to emerge as Germany's highest decorated combatant by war's end, led his Staffel on the opening day of Zitadel flying a twin cannon armed Ju-87G. This variant of the Stuka had been deployed as one of a number of Luftwaffe types considered for the role of flying anti-tank guns to help the army break the flood of Soviet armor in the east. Ordered into production in early 1943 and based upon a modified D airframe, the redesignated G carried two adapted 37mm flak 18 cannons in pods mounted under wing. Although the Ju-87G also carried HE rounds, it was the high-density wolfram cored ammunition that was used when the type was employed in the anti-tank role. Rudel's reputation as a solo panzer knacker flying the 87G began on the 5th of July when he destroyed 12 Soviet T-34s. This Soviet tank was vulnerable when attacked from the rear, where its armor was thinner and could be penetrated by the 37mm cannon. Four Staffeln of HS-129s operating as a flying anti-tank force under Hauptmann Bruno Mayer played a formidable role during Zitadel. In addition to its standard armament of two 20mm cannon and two heavy machine guns, the most significant addition to the 129 units employed at Kursk was a 30mm Mark 101 high-velocity cannon mounted under the fuselage in a streamlined gondola. This weapon was employed against Soviet tanks in the same fashion as the 37mm cannon on the Ju-87G. The effectiveness of the cannon-armed 129s was proven when, on the 8th of July, a brigade of Soviet tanks attacked the flank of the SS Panzer Corps. Meyer's 129 swept down on the enemy T-34s and opened fire from a distance of 550 yards, whilst Focke-Wulf 190 ground attack aircraft assailed the supporting Soviet infantry, dropping high fragmentation bombs. Just an hour after the battle began, 50 Soviet tanks littered the battlefield, all destroyed from the air. A fortnight after Hitler called off Zitadel, the Soviet forces in the south of the salient went over to the counterattack and rapidly recaptured all territory lost to the Germans. This Soviet push now melded into the one that had been operating against the German forces in the Orel Bulge since the 10th of July. Along the whole of the southern front for the remainder of the month and throughout August, the Stuka units found themselves being transferred from one danger point to another, flying sortie after sortie, supporting the ground forces in their attempt to halt the increasing number of Soviet breakthroughs. Stuka Group 77 found itself regularly moved with an intensity of sorties that ran from 4 through to 6 on a daily basis all during this period. Throughout the Gruppe, the personal sortie tallies of aircrew rose steeply. In September, Werner Peipel recorded his 800th. Just 8 months before, he'd been decorated with the Knight's Cross for having reached the grand total of 480, while many others recorded having flown 400, 500 and 600 sorties. Nor was the task of flying the Ju-87 in combat becoming any easier. Although the Red Air Force was less effective than the Allied Air Forces in the West, 1943 had seen a marked improvement in the quality of both pilots and planes. At a time when fighter units were being pulled back to Germany to defend the Reich, the increasingly vulnerable Stuka was having to fly in an increasingly hostile sky, often devoid of the vital fighter escorts it needed in order to survive. In addition, the Red Army was increasing by a substantial degree the protection it gave its ground forces by the addition of many more anti-aircraft guns. These moved with the advancing spearheads. With the tendency of Soviet infantry to shoot at German aircraft with every caliber of weapon to hand, the lot of Stuka crews was made exceedingly dangerous.
Noch einmal setzen die Maschinen zum Angriff an.
In the autumn of 1943, the newsreel caught the celebrations marking the 100,000th sortie flown by Stuka Geschwader II, subsequently redesignated Schlachtgeschwader II Immelmann since its commencement of operations in September 1939. Present at the formal presentation was Hauptmann Rudel, wearing his Knight's Cross with oak leaves. Presentations of Knight's Crosses to other aircrew were also made. The very high number of sorties gives some indication of the pace of operations experienced by German aircrew. The wreckage of smashed Soviet armour seen here during the very fierce fighting that took place at Krivoy Rog and the Dnieper Bend late in 1943 is testimony to the Stuka's low-level assault role. This became its primary function after October 1943, when the Luftwaffe abandoned dive bombing and the Stuka Geschwaden were redesignated Schlachtgruppen. Although in the West the effectiveness of the Stuka as a tank destroyer using bombs was regarded more as propaganda, in Russia it is clear that many Stuka pilots demonstrated a remarkable ability in bombing tanks at low level and destroying them. While this footage shows some Stukas operating at medium altitude, it also shows other Ju-87D5s swooping down at very low level, strafing the targets and aiming their bombs with great precision directly onto the hulls of T-34s. Far more Stukas were lost to Soviet ground fire during the period 1941 to 1945 than were ever lost to enemy fighters, notwithstanding the earlier observations about the improvement in Soviet air power. As can be seen here, Schlachtflieger attracted flak in massive quantity. In late March 1944, Rudel, now a major and in command of the 3rd Gruppe of Schlachtgeschwader II, achieved two career milestones. Having completed his 1,800th sortie, he then notched up the destruction of his 200th Soviet tank while flying his cannon-armed Ju-87G. In recognition of his achievement, Hitler awarded him Germany's then highest wartime decoration of the diamonds to his Knight's Cross. In the following months, he was awarded the Pilot Observer's Badge with diamonds and the Flight Class for Schlachtflieger in gold and platinum. This award was personalized with his sortie number 2000 highlighted in diamonds. Further promotion to Oberstleutnant followed, and on the 1st of October 1944, Rudel was given command of Schlachtgeschwader II. With the initiative on the Eastern Front now having passed irrevocably to the Red Army, film of military operations from the winter of 43-44 illustrate that most actions which show the German army attacking the Soviets are limited counterattacks of a tactical nature. Self-propelled artillery and salvos of rockets from Werfers would precede the advance of panzers, accompanied overhead by Stuka ground support. Where, however, such counterattacks were directed at a point of major Soviet offensive effort, the Red Air Force could be expected to respond quickly. Ilyushin II Sturmoviks, providing the Soviet equivalent of the Schlachtflieger, would begin their own attacks on the advancing German forces. The effectiveness of this heavily armed Soviet type led it to being dubbed the Black Death by German infantry. The arrival of the Stukas points to a further assault on the Soviet positions. However, the manner in which this attack is depicted by the editors of the film, in terms of the images and of the sound effects, is testimony to the continuing propaganda value of the Stuka being depicted as a dive bomber, even at this late stage of the conflict. The emergence of specialized ground attack variants of the versatile Focke-Wulf 190 fighter had been prompted by the ever-growing demands of the army for more effective close support and the obvious inadequacy of the aging Stuka to fulfill the task. This role was satisfied by the F model of the 190. The need for a longer-ranging fighter bomber also saw the emergence of the G series. Both types entered service in 1943 with the first Stukagruppen converting to their new mounts early in the year. Even though 1943 was to see no fewer than 1,800 Stukas leave the production lines, by October the rate of conversion from Ju-87 to Fw-190 was taking place at the rate of 2 Gruppen every 6 weeks. However, it was only in 1944, when production of the 190 underwent major expansion, did sufficient aircraft become available with which to continue re-equipping the remaining Stuka Schlachtgruppen on the Eastern Front. By June 1944 and the opening of the Soviet summer offensive, there were 7 Schlachtgruppen operating approximately 200 Fw-190s on the Russian front. By mid-summer 1944, Rudel was not only highly decorated, but also the darling of the propaganda department, and one of the most familiar faces to German audiences watching the weekly newsreel. Rudel was not embarrassed by this interest that bordered on hero worship, being more than happy to show off his physical prowess and his concern with maintaining a vigorous and healthy lifestyle. Whilst held in great respect by his fellow flyers, there were, however, more than a few who observed with a wry grin and a wink that Major Rudel neither drinks alcohol nor smokes cigarettes. By the late summer and early autumn of 1944, only Rudel's third group of Schlachtflieger II, along with the specialized anti-tank Staffel, were still operating the Stuka in daylight operations on the Eastern Front. Indeed, all footage of Stukas seen hereafter in this film operating in daylight come only from these formations. In spite of the vulnerability of the Stuka, Rudel continued to express a preference for operating the type, and even though he was checked out on the Fw-190, often flew operations in one. There were those who believed, as did Rudel, that the Stuka still had a role to play in daylight operations, and that, under conditions of local air superiority, remained a highly effective precision bombing type. By this time, most Stukas operating in the east, and indeed the only ones serving in the west, were operated by the Nacht Schlachtgruppen in the night assault role. Effective ground-to-air communications provided by the Luftwaffe radio operatives in their own command half-tracks operating alongside army formations allowed the flexible and rapid deployment of Stuka formations in the ground attack role. Observed by Luftwaffe General Robert Ritter von Greim, a Kampfgruppe panzers, assault guns, self-propelled guns and infantry prepares to launch a counterattack on dug-in Soviet forces. Prior to their assault, Stukas carry out a preliminary low-level bombardment of the Soviet positions. In a addition to employing normal high-explosive bombs, a number of the Stukas would also use SD-2 or 3 anti-personnel bomblets. Another favoured weapon employed by the Stuka in the assault role was a special weapons container equipped with three fixed and angled MG-81 heavy machine guns for ground strafing. This sequence is notable for the manner in which it illustrates the diverse range of Stuka variants operating with Rudel's third Gruppe of SG-2 Immelmann in the late summer of 1944. Early Ju-87 D-2s and D-3s, still retaining their dive brakes, operate alongside the later D-5s and the specialised anti-tank Ju-87 Gs. The D-2s and 3s are armed with SC-250 or SC-500 bombs under the fuselage and four SC-50 bombs under wing. The latter are fitted with extended percussion detonators. It is the earlier variants of the D that retain their underwing dive brakes and is still employed in the classic dive bombing role. While abandoned under official policy, retention of this capability was clearly deemed by Rudel as Geschwader commander to still have its place in the repertoire of Stuka tactics. By this stage of the conflict, massive Soviet summer offensives have pushed the Wehrmacht out of European Russia, with the Stukas operating against Red Army forces driving into the Baltic state of Lithuania. Evidence of the effectiveness of Soviet flak is a hit to the leading edge of this D-5, just outboard of its 20mm MG-151 cannon barrel. By the time this film was taken of HS-129Bs taking off to attack Soviet forces in September 44, production of the type had already ended. The last 24 of 866 manufactured mounted an adapted 75mm anti-tank gun. While able to kill even the IS-2 heavy tank, this 129 variant proved extremely vulnerable. The loss rate of the Henschel 129 in the specialised anti-tank Schlachtgeschwaden began to climb in 1944 by virtue of the improvement in Soviet fighter opposition and ground defences. Although a small target, the low-powered French Gnome Rhone engines did not endow the Henschel with a sparkling performance, the maximum speed of the B-2 being 253 miles per hour, with the heavily laden 75mm armed B-3 realising just 199 miles an hour at sea level. Pilot losses reached 20% by mid-year, with the type becoming a declining asset in the Luftwaffe inventory in consequence. Whether or not the Soviet leader Joseph Stalin deliberately held back his forces from giving support to the Polish Home Army when it rose against the Germans in Warsaw in August 1944, is still a matter of some debate among historians. In practice, the lack of Soviet opposition in the skies above Warsaw allowed Stukas to operate with impunity in support of German forces in their drive to reduce the city and fulfill Hitler's demand that it be leveled to the ground. The fighting continued through to October, with Stukas in operation throughout that period. Although he had been shot down and wounded in August and November, Rudel insisted in flying ops in his Ju-87G, even though he was not yet fully recovered. By the end of December 1944, his tally of destroyed Soviet tanks had risen to 460, with another 40 being added by the end of January. In early February, he crash-landed his flak-riddled Stuka and was badly wounded. His right leg was so badly damaged that it was amputated. Even though by this time he was Germany's most highly decorated combatant, having become the only recipient of the specially struck golden oak leaf swords and diamonds, even this injury was not enough to keep him from flying.
den endgültigen Sieg erringen.
January and February 1945 saw the launch of massive Soviet offensives that drove the Red Army from the Vistula River across Poland to the banks of the Oder. By this time, the Schlachtflieger were on the wane, worn down by excessive losses of pilots and machines. Nevertheless, the limited footage taken of the fighting in this period shows the few surviving Henschel 129s in action along with the tank-busting Ju-87Gs. In spite of the overwhelming Soviet air power, they're still clearly reaping great damage to Soviet armor on the snow-covered fields of Pomerania. Continued film of the operations of this variant of the Stuka is testimony to the very different air war fought in the East as compared to that in the West. Here, the Ju-87 had not been able to show itself in daylight since 1943 for fear of massacre. It is perhaps the ultimate paradox that the very last film ever taken of a Luftwaffe aircraft in action for the newsreel should be of an anti-tank Ju-87G on a solo sortie attacking Soviet armor on the Oder in March 1945. Slow, ponderous, poorly protected, vulnerable, a sitting duck. It is unlikely that the poor Soviet tankers on the receiving end of this Stuka's firing run and dying so close to final victory would have gained any consolation from the knowledge that, according to many experts, the plane that killed them was no longer up to the task. Hans-Ulrich Rudel and the Junkers Ju-87 Stuka have since become the stuff of legend, for while he emerged as Germany's highest decorated soldier, with a combat record second to none, there is no doubting that the Stuka was and still is regarded as the foremost symbol of Luftwaffe air power during World War II. The images of Stukas plunging earthwards, sirens screaming like banshees, will forever be remembered as one of the most terrifying images of 20th century warfare.